opportunity to welcome you all to our celebration of Black Heritage Month, which is February. And in honor of Black Heritage Month, we have asked Robert and Sylvia Ray to come to be our guest. We're very, very grateful to the Norman Arts and Humanities Council, who has so graciously helped fund this event. We were fortunate to have them 2 years ago, and they helped fund this. We're delighted that they thought this was a worthy project, and they've given us the funds again. Tonight, the reason, for the first time, and I've been here about 100 years, we ask for a contribution of you all, because all funds have been cut with the Arts and Humanities Council, and so we appreciate your support to help us with this event. It gives me a great deal of pleasure to tell you a little bit about Robert Ray and Sylvia. I met Robert and Sylvia at Snow Mountain Ranch in 1981. A while ago, I went back to see what year it was because I thought it had been longer, at a choral arts seminar. And when I met them, I thought, what a wonderful thing to bring to where I was teaching, which was Central at the time. And I came over here that year, and I thought, what a great thing for students to experience. What a wonderful experience we would have together. And so I started conniving in my mind how we could get the money to have them come. And someone mentioned, write a grant. And so we wrote the grant, and we wrote it again this year, and that's how we were able to bring Robert and Sylvia here. Robert, as you can read in your program, all of his wonderful experience, I would like to tell you that he is a teacher at the Conservatory of Music in St. Louis. He teaches at Forest Park Community College, which he's just started this semester, class piano. And he is also the Minister of Music at St. Paul's AME Church in St. Louis. He has his degree in piano from the University of Illinois and also from Northwestern University in Chicago. Sylvia has her degree from the University of Illinois, and she's an administrative assistant in the St. Louis school system. Our drummer is John Cuff, and he is the Norman High senior, and he is the drummer for the Tiger Connection, and he also belongs to a band named Perfect Stranger. And later I will tell you about our other two guests that are on this program. At this time, would you please welcome Robert Ray.
I think it had been snowing 65 below and all that in St. Louis before it actually got here to Norman, so I think we might have brought it, so I'm sorry about that. But we have had such a marvelous time with warm vibes and warm spirits in the rehearsals that we've had with your choir and with the students and with Don and the Germans and everybody. It's just been the cold weather on the outside has not affected anything that we've done so far on the inside, so we're grateful for that. We've been having a marvelous time just sharing experiences. You know, it's marvelous that Afro-American, Black, whatever you want to call it, History Month has been given to give us an opportunity to simply put on more public display many of the incredible aspects that we experience as an Afro-American person every day in terms of our culture, and to get a chance to share it with people that don't get a chance to hear it and see it in its everyday setting. So what we've been doing with your students these last couple of days is showing them how, in one particular area, in a two-day period, you can't cover all of Afro-American music. In a two-day period, you can focus in on one particular area and give them a real in-depth look at musical style traditions, how it works, how it's put together, what happens, what should happen, what shouldn't happen, etc., in Afro-American music. For this occasion, since I've written a gospel mat, we decided to focus in on the element of gospel music and how it, over the years, has evolved and developed into an incredibly complicated art form that began as a very important folk origin. And so for the last 2 days, from Africa to the present, we've been tracing all kinds of gospel styles and for what we call in music, vocal performance practices of how to go about singing gospel music in the Afro-American tradition. Because there's a very strong white gospel tradition that is another whole area of gospel development. But in the Afro-American spirit, heritage, because of our unique heritage coming from Africa, there's some very obvious differences between the two. So what we've done on this last couple of days is given the students an opportunity to experience firsthand what happens in a gospel work, so that when they approach a work like the Gospel Mass, that is a bit more complicated than some of the gospel that we do at the folk level, they have a greater understanding. It's not just a bunch of notes going through the page, but that the real key to understanding it comes from a better understanding of the culture from which it came and why it has to be that way, why the rhythms have to be that way, why the drums have to do certain things, why the vocalists improvise in a certain way, how the workings, you know, even in our African heritage, the workings of the spirit, how the spirit comes about and works in a gospel setting to create sometimes the very form of a piece, because it's totally dependent upon what happens at the moment. A piece can be created right on the spot by just what you want to happen rather than some preconceived idea by a composer or by a writer. So we have had a great time sharing, and they have shown me. One young lady I haven't had a chance to hear yet, but before I leave here, I'm going to hear some compositions by this one young lady in the choir. So it's just been a truly marvelous sharing experience. So we thought for the first part of the program tonight, before we go into the Gospel Mass, that I would ask Mrs. Ray to do several gospel selections that demonstrate what we've been talking about in terms of the solo singing style of Afro-American music. And what we've said is that what the kids and I have been talking about is the idea that when you approach any form of music, the first thing you have to be aware of is the culture out of which it came. That will then determine what kind of voice quality you use. That will determine the extent to which you do certain things like sliding on pitches and hitting other pitches and taking it up higher here, lower there. Everything that you do is determined by the culture out of which the work came. What you do in Mozart, you certainly wouldn't do in James Cleveland or Andre Crouch. That they're totally different styles. And so what I want Mrs. Ray to come and do as she performs in concert for you for the next few moments is to do maybe four selections, each one showing us a different aspect of the singing art. Now, you know, one good thing about gospel performance is that in the Afro-American experience, there is no audience. You are performers. It's nice to see you. Well, I can't really see you because the lights are kind of in my eye. But it's nice for you to sit out there and enjoy. But there's also the element that you are involved with the performance itself. And if something's happening on stage that sounds kind of good and you want to join in with the patting of the feet, if you want to clap your hands a little bit, if you want to kind of wave your hand a little bit, whatever you feel like doing in terms of assisting the performance, because you are, other than your ears, your whole body becomes an active participant in the performance. So at this time, I'm going to give you my wife, Mrs. Sylvia Ray, and she's going to give you four gospel selections illustrating different styles of singing and our fantastic drummer, Mr. John.
Oh,
Thank you.
Thank you.
just a total of a gamut, range of vocal inflections, dynamic, just the whole gamut of things that you experience in all the world's great music. Now, when we come to the Mass, we'll have a few more things to say about the kind of thing that can happen, that should happen in gospel music. At this point, I'm going to reintroduce Ms. Johnson. She's going to get the Norman Choir. You're going to hear an incredible arrangement of Ms. Patty Brennan. So, stand up.
We're really fortunate here in Norman to have so much wonderful help. I would like at this time to thank Patty Brennan, who is the choral director at Westman High, and also Linda Jones, who is the choral director at Central Mid High, who sent me wonderful students, and also who helps Team Teach over here at Norman High. Tonight we're having the premiere work of Send the Light. Patty Brennan has arranged it, and we're delighted. Patty has a degree in music education from Oklahoma State University, that other place, and a master's from the wonderful place of the University of Oklahoma, except she might not agree with the order I gave that. And her husband, who is playing bass, Jim Drennan, is an attorney in Oklahoma City. He has 2 degrees from Oklahoma State University in industrial engineering and his law degree from the University of Oklahoma. And we're delighted to have them, and I wish you would welcome them at this time for Patty Brennan's premier arrangement of Send the Light. If my students will come down now at this time, please. Thank you.
telling the kids earlier today, sometimes, you know, a prophet is not without honor save in his own country. And too often, you know, we have great personalities in our communities and in our midst doing incredible things. And we get so used to just saying, oh, there's old Patty up there again, you know. Oh, there's Miss Drennan. Oh, she's just playing what she normally does, you know. And we forget that here is a really incredibly creative young lady. And I was telling the choir that I'm sincerely hoping that I'm going to do my best to get her work out there and published. And what you heard tonight might be the beginning, the launching of a major career as a gospel writer, a gospel arranger. And you are here as a part of it. Kind of important. Let's give her another hand here. I can remember when we did the gospel mass for the very first time at my own college. And I don't think at that point, you know, at that point I was just like Patty. I was Robert Ray. I was a choir director. I'd been around the University of Illinois for 20 years. And here we were just doing another little piece that I'd written one day. And whoever thought that, you know, some 7-8 years later, this piece that was written for the University of Illinois Black Choir would be performed literally all over the world. I get letters from all over the country, all over the continent, saying they had done the mass and you know, how much they enjoyed the mass, etc. And I had no idea at the time of writing that the piece would ever take off in the way that it had and get the response that it has from people. So I'm saying to you, what you heard here tonight with Miss Drennan could well be the making of a new career. So we're going to pray with her and ask God, Lord, to bless her career as she goes on. Amen. Now, you know what? We came here to have church today. Amen.
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 I think I heard an amen out there, somebody. In the black church, most of the time, we say amen. What does it mean to have church? Having church is synonymous with having a good time. When we come to church, you know, especially in the older church, and even nowadays, you know, in slave times, you would come with problems. You would come with problems with interpersonal problems. You would come with problems with your slave owners, slave masters, etc. And who wanted to come to church and be weighted down with burdens and problems? So you came to church with the idea of the religious experience lifting you out of your daily problems. So it's for that reason that the Afro-American worship experience is usually a very joyous celebration. Amen?
Amen.
We believe that everything that's dead ought to be buried. Literally. Quite literally. So we came, we've been having a good time, but we wanted to somehow get you involved in this good time process, because we know many of you probably have not experienced this particular kind of music, and you're probably thinking, what is this they're doing at Norman High School? What has Jonna Johnson got them up to now? What is she doing with those kids? So we thought we'd teach you at least one song that would then give you an opportunity to experience firsthand what they experienced in terms of the last couple of days. The first song we learned was Glory, Glory. Let's get some words. I want you to repeat after me. We're going to teach you this song in true gospel style. Repeat the words after me. Glory, glory.
Glory, glory.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Since I laid my
burdens down.
Glory, glory.
Glory, glory.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Since I laid my
burdens down.
You know, coming out of the old church, when many of our grandparents, great-grandparents, could not read, they had not had the opportunity to get the formal education that we are so grateful for today. So they established an incredible oral tradition. Everything was taught by word of mouth, by rote. So we're going to teach you the melody. You know, they're not going to have a sheet there or a hymn book or anything in front of you to read the words. You're going to learn it, just like we learned it as an Afro-American people. Glory, glory.
Glory, glory.
Hallelujah.
I feel better,
so much better. Like this.
Glory, glory, glory. time again how much I care. Sometimes I feel my heart will overflow.
Very simple song. Very simple. All the words say that I feel like going home. And we don't know about you, but boy, I get kind of rough sometimes. The song says, though trials come on every man, I feel like going home. No matter what. No matter what they come, no matter what the world is going to heap on me, they're going to heap a whole bunch of stuff before this life is over. No matter what's going to happen, I still feel like going on. As these young people get ready to go out into life, I want to take that song with me. I want them to continue to feel, no matter what the odds, no matter what people say, no matter what people do, always feel like going on. Because though trials come on every hand, we want them today to feel like going on. Found out that there was very little written for the liturgy in terms of gospel music. There were lots of individual gospel tunes by various gospel writers, but not a whole lot of these that had been written specifically for the liturgy. So back in about 1978-79, I set out to write a musical setting of what we call the ordinary text of the Mass. And these were the portions of the Mass that were used all the time before Vatican II. You would come into the church, and the first thing you would hear would be Kyrie eleison. Then you go a little further in the service, and you get Glory to God, Gloria in excelsis Deo. Then you get in Latin, Credo in unum Deum, I believe in God. And then you get finally the Sanctus, Sanctus Dominus Deus Sabaoth. And then finally you get Agnus Dei, Lamb of God. This was the standard format for the church in Latin. And so what I set out to do in an English version was to combine the elements of the Mass text, which had come to us through the centuries pretty much unchanged until Robert Ray got to them, and the traditional music with the exciting rhythms of the traditional black church. So what happened was I sat down and started writing this thing, and I was thinking, my God, how am I going to do this? What's it going to be like to try to put together those two disparate elements? And then I suddenly realized that there's a certain commonality of experience. I don't care who you are, I don't care what color you are, I don't care what race, creed, or whatever you are. There are certain things that exist in life, period, that transcend all of those things. Now, we may not have said in the black church, Kyrie eleison, or Christe eleison, but we know that in the black church, we've been saying, Lord, have mercy, for a long time. Amen? We may not have said, Gloria in excelsis Deo, et in terra pax hominibus, etc. But we've been saying, Glory, Lord, thank you. I love you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. We've been saying glory to God in different ways for centuries, you know? And the same thing with all the rest of the movement. So gradually, what seemed to be a very difficult task, when you put together that human element that transcends all of life and that we all experience, it became a very easy. And the Mass was written in a week. I spent 1 week writing the Mass itself. The creative part took a week to create, and the part I hated sitting down and writing our part. Amen, Patty. Amen. For any composer, that has to be the biggest drudgery in the world, sitting down and just, the soprano sing this, and the alto, and then the bass player has to sing, and then, oh, God, by the time you get through with that, all the inspiration you had is just lost, you know. But, we sat down and spent a week in the creative process of writing the Mass, and then another week in actually notating of the Mass, of what you see in the copy. Well, they don't have copies today, but the copies that they have is what you see of that notation process. It's been a marvelous experience working with these young people, and let me say right now, because when the Mass is ended, it's usually not an opportunity to say the kinds of things that I want to say to these people here at Norman that have worked so hard. First of all, to the choir, thank you for working so hard, for Ms. Johnson for preparing them so well, so that when I come and just wave my little hand, they just do all kinds of magical things. Believe me, I've been in so many places where that doesn't happen. You come in and they're struggling over parts, they haven't got it learned, and you're simply trying your best to put together a decent performance in a couple of days. But when you come into Norman, boy, it's just a joy, because everything is just so well learned. Choir, first of all, thank you very much for doing a fine job of workmanship. Secondly, thanks to all of my instrumentalists. They have introduced now Mr. Jim Drennan on the bass. Jim, stand up. And his wife, Patty Drennan, on piano. And John Thump on drums. And finally, the lady that has made all of this possible and just a dear friend for life, Mama Jane. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. We give you this evening a gospel.
Oh, Thank you.
love for y'all to come and join us. Thank you. There's a reception following in the choir room. If you would like to meet the Rays, we invite you in.